welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm your host, Kendra Cook. The Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles, located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, has dozens of vehicles on display, everything from horse-drawn carriages and wagons to motorized cars and trucks. If you would like to contact the Boyertown Museum, you have a choice of several ways to do that. You can give us a call at 610-367-2090. You can visit our website at www.boyertownmuseum.org. And if you can't find the answer to your question on our website, please feel free to email us at mail@boyertownmuseum.org. The museum is open for visitors Tuesday through Sunday, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. We are closed Mondays and most major holidays. A reminder that the end of this month, August 31st, will be the 48th annual Duryea Day Antique and Classic Car, Truck, and Motorcycle Show and Flea Market, which is put on by the Boyertown Museum and the Pottstown Region AACA. The show is at Boyertown Community Park, a beautiful shaded park, and we hope to see all of you at home there at the park on August 31st. The show is from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. If you would like to register your car, truck, or motorcycle for the show, please contact the museum and we'll send you a registration form. And you can also register the day of the show as well. And we can now move on to the program. I gave you that Duryea Day announcement. And we'd like to welcome all of you at home and thank you for joining us here at Wheels Along the Road this evening. And we broadcast live the first Tuesday of every month. And we do encourage our home viewers to give us a call. The number here at the studio is 610-378-0426. And you'll especially want that number for the end of the show when we do the car quiz. And I'll give it that number to you again when we get to the car quiz, too. I welcome regular panelists Dan Olsen and Mike Yanessa here this evening.
Thanks
for being here, guys.
Thank you.
Our special guest tonight is Dave MAlloy of Trap Generator Service. And we thank you, Dave, for being here with us tonight.
Well, thanks for the invitation. I appreciate it.
We're glad to have you. Well, let's start right off with the show. And Dan, what are you going to share with us this evening?
I am going to be sharing some miscellaneous auto stuff. Okay, how's that sound? I was looking through some older automotive magazines, as in 1922, and there's different advertisements and short articles in there about different new products that are coming out, and I picked three of them out, and they concern things that we have on our cars, or used to have on our cars, that we could sort of take for granted. And it's very interesting because these are aftermarket, meaning they did not come when you bought the car at the dealer. Maybe the dealer put them on for you, or you could just go down to, maybe get them through Sears and Roebuck or whatever and get them. And the first item here is called the Jiffy Windshield Cleaner, okay? I was telling somebody about this item, and they corrected me. I said it was a windshield wiper, and they said, no, it's a windshield cleaner. And for $1.50, you could have the motorist favorite. That's how the way they described that. It was made by the Levetz Manufacturing Company of New Haven, Connecticut. And what it would do is clean both sides of your windshield at the same time. I know that picture's kind of detailed there, but what it was roughly a U-shaped piece of aluminum with a rubber wiper blade inside both legs of the U. And that rubber, the rubber blade would be on both sides of the windshield. You take the handle, you just move it left to right or right to left across the windshield. It would wipe the dirt and the rain off of both sides at the same time. And Kendra, if you could show the next picture, please. At the top of it, that shows a windshield, basically as you would see it on a car in the early 20s. And if you notice, there's a line, a horizontal line across the middle. Well, the windshield will be separated there, and that's where you would put this Jiffy windshield cleaner. You know, the bottom of the U would be where the separation would be. And so you would just do like the top half of the windshield with this cleaner, and it would, you know, it's a rather simple device, but again, there were not windshield wipers. You know, of course, there was not windshield cleaners there, as my car has it right now. You just kind of pull the thing, and all this water comes on your windshield, and so on and so forth. Again, you know, we're talking the old days there. And I could see maybe condensation would build up on something like that, too, and you just have your windshield cleaner. I keep wanting to say windshield wiper, but the cleaner, you just take the handle and just move it to the other side of the windshield, and presto, you have a clean windshield. They called it the fastest selling, most efficient cleaner ever offered to the trade. And again, we're talking 1922 here. Okay, now the next product, we can keep that picture on there, because this is actually a patent drawing for the next item, which is called a Benser wind deflector. And a guy I know, a friend of mine, has a set of wind deflectors on his old Chalmers, and he pointed this out to me. And a little history here, the company was the Benser Corporation out of Brooklyn, New York, and Henry and Lois Benser, or Louis Benser, had this new wind deflector. Now, if you look at cars from that era, they had the wind deflectors was a little hunk of glass that was attached to the windshield post off to the side. It would deflect the wind so it wouldn't buffet you around inside the car. Well, they came up with this new idea for this wind deflector, and also they were thinking, if a car has a rear view mirror on it, which again would be mounted on the windshield post, it was kind of hard to change the position of that mirror. So they came up with this idea of combining it together. And they came with the mirror was incorporated with the deflector. So on the lower left-hand corner, that picture shows one windshield deflector or wind deflector, and a circular part of it towards the top of that is a hollowed out area. And what they would do, they'd hollow out the glass or transparent material and coat it with silver paint and then coat over it so it wouldn't wear out. And so looking through the wind deflector, you would see this silver circle, which is actually your mirror. And it was actually convex. Okay, yeah, that's right. Convex, so it would enlarge the things that were behind you so you could look through. And I thought that was kind of a novel idea there. So anyway, they were made with the finest quarter-inch beveled plate glass. As I said, the glass was a preferred material, but in their patent, they says you could have used any transparent material. And it was just silver to create the mirror. And that's kind of an interesting little thing. I've only seen one of them, and that's my friend Bob's car has them. And, you know, now I'm kind of keeping an eye out on these older cars when you go to car shows. The Benser company also made some other automotive products. All of them were glass. They made the Ruby taillight lens. They advertised that as made from the finest ruby glass. They also made flower vases. You know, back then they had for decoration inside a car. Sometimes at old car shows you see they'll have a little vase or a vase in their car. They also made headlight lenses. If you could show the next picture, Kendra. And there's an advertisement. You can see the deflector there. And, okay. And, yeah, that just sort of describes about it. And you see in the lower left-hand corner, you see the Benser lens, which was a Type A headlight lens. I don't know what they meant by Type A, but there you go. If you could show the next picture, there's another advertisement. Yeah, there you go. And they show how, you know, no glare, best in headlights So that was the Benzer Corporation. Now the next item, the third item here is called the Splittdorf Air Spring. Now Splittdorf was well known back in the teens and 20s for their electrical products for cars. They're out of Newark, New Jersey. And if you could show the first picture there, okay. Well, I'm a little quick with this, but we'll get to that picture in a moment. Anyway, Splittdorf was known for their products, and they made spark plugs, magnetos, generators, starting and lighting systems. Again, you know, these cars had hand cranks. Well, not in the 20s, but in the teens, and you could buy an aftermarket starting kit for your, you know, 19-aught something, and Splittdorf made them. They also made cigarette lighters, which again are electric product, and they also made radios, but it wasn't radio that you could stick in a car, but it was the old cabinet type that you'd sit on a table in your home. And I found all sorts of stuff. I saw phonograph records that they made. I was looking through the internet and I saw a speed control thing. I thought, wow, this is great speed control for like a 1920 Model T or something. Well, it was for a record player, or a phonograph player, so it kind of got me excited for no reason there. Anyway, back to the Splittdorf Air Spring. I saw this Model T Ford, this is a 1921, I saw for sale at Carlisle in the spring. And it caught my eye because it had this weird looking thing on the front axle. You can show the next picture, show it up close, and there's your Splittdorf air spring. You can see the wheel, spokes of the wheel are to the right, your axle will be along the bottom of the picture. And the way this is connected is when a car hits a pothole or a bump or something, there's a little lever on the bottom of that and it pushes up inside of that cup item. Now inside that cup is a rubber ball, and it's made from the fine grade of para crude rubber. Okay, not Bucron this time, but a para crude rubber, which is a natural rubber made from South America. And so there was a hollow rubber ball under that, and this lever would push up against it, and that would absorb the shock of a hole or a bump in the road. Now, the little fitting at the top is an actual air fitting, so you could adjust the pressure, the PSI within that ball, so you can make it a stiffer ride or a softer ride, depending on how you had it. And so that's a Splittdorf air spring. If you could show the next picture, please. Thank you, Kendra. And that shows everything there. You see the ball kind of peeking out on the bottom there, and you see the lever that would push up inside of that. And they said the rebound is said to be considerably minimized because the fact that the sluggish action of a hollow rubber ball enables the car to regain its normal position with ease. That's a little bit of advertising talk there. And they worked on this for some years before they came out with it. You bought a set of four of them and you wanted to put them on your Cadillac, it would cost you $100, which I think is pretty good money back then.
Yeah, it's a lot of money.
A Ford would be $35, which is still pretty good money. Now, if you came to the museum, we have SGV, which happens to be on display in our lobby, and that has Westinghouse air shocks. And kind of the same principle. It doesn't have a rubber ball in it, but it has it's a piston action, but it's controlled by air pressure again. And I've only seen them on expensive cars, but here we have something a lot cheaper, and they advertise it as being put on Fords, and you saw the photograph of the Model T sitting there. And so it was kind of interesting coming across these things. You know, we don't even think about shock absorbers in our car. You know, we go over railroad tracks and something. You know, we might slow down for them. And they're pretty comfortable going across. And back then, like Model T Fords didn't even have them. They just had the springs. You'd bounce all over the place. And this is something that would absorb those bouncing. So, again, that was these three items here. The windshield cleaner, the wind deflector, and the air spring. Things you don't think about. And they didn't come with the cars. And you had to buy them extra there. And so that's it. Something for you to think about.
Thanks, Dan.
Yep.
I like the silvered mirror.
You like that's, the silver mirror. Okay.
Clever.
I think so too. Yep.
All right. Well, next we have Mike. Mike, it's good to see you this month. We missed you last time.
Yeah, I wasn't here last month. So.
Welcome back. And,
thank you.
Let us know what's going on at Wheels in Motion.
I will. I'm going to take the time tonight just to give a little lecture, I guess you'd say, on brakes. A lot of customers come to me with their old cars with brake issues, and most of them come and they say these drum brakes just don't work, and they want to put disc brakes on it or four-wheel disc brakes, which is fine for your hot rod or your modified car, but unfortunately, a lot of the shows I see some antique cars with disc brakes on them that are original. And it's not necessary. I think it's a misconception sometimes. If you have drum brakes on your car, and they're serviced right, and they're adjusted right and everything, usually they'll stop just fine. Now they might not stop as good as your brand new Lexus or your brand new Cadillac, but they definitely do the job. They're designed for that car's weight back in the day. And there's some common mistakes that people make with the drum brakes, which are going to go over. But first, disc brakes date all the way back to 1890, believe it or not. They were in the 50s they were used, but they didn't become real popular on American cars until 69, early 70s. And they are great. They're a good way to stop a car. Power disc brakes, especially the four-wheel disc brakes, and they have single piston, four piston, eight pistons, which will stop a race car at 200 miles an hour. But when you have an old Chevy or an old Packard or an old Lincoln, the brakes on that car, the drum brakes it was designed with, are usually adequate. Of course, they're hydraulic brakes. Years ago, they were mechanical when we first started out with the Model Ts and the Chevys, and over the years, we've learned how to use fluid to stop the car. The biggest thing I see in drum brakes as a mistake is you put a set of shoes on a car. The shoes' diameter are not the same as the drum. So only a small portion of the shoe touches the drum. So you have to break them in, wear them in. In fact, when I did a lot of race car work, and by the way, my Camaro, which goes 128 miles an hour in a quarter mile, still has the stock drum brakes on it, and it stops just fine. And I won't lie, when you get to 128, 130, that's the limit. But at 125, there's no need for disc brakes in a drag car. In my opinion, the car stops fine. One of the reasons is there's a gentleman in town that years ago when I built the car had a brake shoe arcing machine. And what that would do, you could grind the circumference of the shoe and match it to the drum. Now, unfortunately, they're probably all gone today. I don't know what happened to his. But when you buy a set of shoes at, you know, AutoZone or at a parts store for your old classic car, I can tell you right now that only 25% of the shoe might contact the drum. So there's a couple things you could do. You can fit them yourself, which you have to wear a good respirator and sand them and fit them for the diameter. Or you can just put them on the car, adjust them, and drive the car for a few hundred miles gently, and they will eventually, more and more of the brake shoe will contact the drum, and your brake pedal will become better. But you have to keep them adjusted. Some of the old car drum brakes didn't have self-adjusters, so you have to constantly readjust them. But if you do this and you take the time to buy new hardware, buy new drums, redo the whole brake system, first of all, it's your classic car, it's your life, it's other people's lives, it's an important part of the car. And a lot of people with antique cars, because they're not need to be inspected, they don't bother pulling the drums and checking the brakes, you know, from time to time. You have to do that. Wheel cylinders can start leaking. Brake lines can rust out. So it's very important to maintain your classic and antique drum brakes. I feel that most cars, you can come up with, if you spend some time with them, you can come up with a real nice brake pedal and a car that stops without spending thousands of dollars on a disc brake conversion. Unless it's a hot rod and unless it has a big engine in it, and you really then, with the weight difference, if you change the motor, then you might have to go to disc brakes. But if it's a stock car, usually you can work on your drum brakes to make them work. Silicone brake fluid. I've been using it since the early 80s. There's two negatives with silicone. Some of the real old cars, like I did like a 1929, 1930 Dodge, and the silicone brake fluid actually leaked past the bleeder threads because the threads were like a coarse thread. They weren't a real fine, tight fit. That's the only one in my career that I've ran into that. The other thing is if you're road racing, silicone has a lower boiling point. So if you're road racing, it will boil at 400 degrees, where standard brake fluid is like 1200 degrees or 900. It's way up there. So you can't use it if you're doing road racing or indie racing or something like that. Drag racing's fine. But the advantages with silicone, because it is thinner, it compresses differently. So for example, a perfect example, in 1981, I had a 71 Chevy pickup truck, disc brake on the front, no power. And the brake pedal was hard as a rock, but it stopped. But you needed a foot that, you'd have to push with all your might. There's a lot of old cars like that. There's a lot of old Chevys, a lot of old Fords that really have a hard pedal. When you convert the system to silicone, it gives it a mushy pedal. Almost like you'll think when you're bleeding them in the garage, you'll think that the pedal's mushy, it has air in it, but it's not. It's the silicone that compresses differently. Once you drive the car, if you would actually take it for a little test drive, it'll give you the feeling of power brakes. So if you have a real hard pedal, the car stops, but you have to put too much foot effort into it, you might want to consider silicone. The positives of it is it doesn't absorb moisture. So when the car sits for long periods of time, your wheel cylinders don't rust, your master cylinders don't rust, the lines don't rust. My race car, for example, has had silicone in it since 1985. It's the same master cylinder and the same wheel cylinders from when I built the car. I've changed the shoes once from drag racing. So silicone brake fluid, it takes that hard pedal away, gives you the power brake feeling, and it doesn't require as much maintenance as regular brake fluid. Brake fluid also should be changed. Even the car you drive every day, you should change your brake fluid every few years, get the dirt out, get the moisture out. It'll save you buying calipers and brake lines and wheel cylinders and stuff like that for your car that you drive every day or your classic car. So that's pretty much my speech tonight on brakes. I get asked the question a lot about four-wheel disc brakes and four pistons and single pistons and all that. I try to work with the drum brakes as best as I can, unless the car has been heavily modified. Then it does need a bigger braking system, of course. So that's my tech talk tonight on brakes. But I'd like to mention a couple other things. I'm sure my regular viewers and people know me from my company, Wheels in Motion. And we're in the process of moving both of our shops to one location on High Street. And I'd like to share a couple pictures with you and show you what's going on at the former Dame Chevrolet at 525 High Street in Pottstown. Started out as Kaiser Chevrolet back in the... it's something I didn't check yet, but Mr. Kaiser bought it in 1900. So that's before Chevrolet. I don't know if it was a house. I don't know a lot of the history. So if any of my viewers know, you can contact me and tell me what you know about the building. But somewhere in the 30s, it was a Oldsmobile and I can't think of the others, two brands. But it was an Oldsmobile dealer for a short time. And then in the late 30s, as best as I can tell, it became Kaiser Chevrolet. And then it became Dame Chevrolet. And now it's going to be the home of Wheels in Motion Body Shop and Mechanical Shop all at one location. That's a picture of the showroom as we just started working on it. It has a beautiful showroom. It could hold probably about four or five cars. And Kendra, if you show the next shot, you can see some progress of how it's going along there. We're moving right there at that point. You can keep going, Kendra. Moving some of the stuff out. There's the shop in the back. It's going to be split down the middle, not with a wall or anything, but one side's going to be mechanical, one side's going to be body shop. You can keep going, Kendra. There's replacing all the ceiling tiles in the showroom and lighting and new light bulbs and stuff. You can see the old ceiling is still up under the drop ceiling. It's kind of cool. The building was, the other thing we've been told, the building was originally built as an opera house, but it never opened. It just was built and I guess didn't make it, and then it was turned into a car dealer. So again, I'm going to try to do some research and just give a little more history than what the local people have been telling me. You can keep going, Kendra. You can keep going. That's my guy Bruce. He's the guy that's doing a lot of the renovation work in the showroom, as well as the showroom's all done and we're working on the service bays. And we should be open in about 2 weeks for mechanical, and we should have a grand opening sometime in October for the whole business, both businesses. You can keep going along. Yep. That's the offices that we're just redoing. Pretty good shape, but there's a lot to do yet. Building's in good shape structurally, it just needed to be freshened up. You can keep going, Kendra. That's a guy that's helping me out, Earl Davis. He's a remarkable guy that is helping me market the place and work on it. You can keep going. Yeah. Hopefully we'll get to the finish. Now, oh yeah, okay, we're starting to paint red and white. My colors are usually red and black, red and white, and it's coming along. You can keep going, Kendra. Yep. Now, as you can see, the red paint. You can keep going pretty fast. It's just a bunch of pictures of now we're starting to get it in shape. The checkerboard floor is in, the 59 Chevy's on the showroom, and it's moving along pretty good now. How about that? Mm-hmm. It really brightened it up. I wanted to go with more of a nostalgia look, but I wanted to keep it modern too, and it did it. It works real well. It doesn't look old. It just has a hint of nostalgia with modern. We're going to have TVs in the showroom and a waiting room, and that's something that how about that shot? That's a shot that my son took that just everybody remarks on. He had it on Facebook and everybody liked it.
Makes it look like it's 1959.
This is if you guys, I don't think I shared this with you. This is a car I was trying to buy. Yeah, I did. I did a whole series on when I revived it. This is the 59 Chevy that I revived that I tried to buy for 16 years. And it was bought new at Kaiser Chevrolet. Mm-hmm. So it returns once again to the showroom. And that's the new sign for the front of the building. So, and there's the 31 Roadster that made it to the showroom on Saturday. So this is a fairly new picture here. And that's about it. There's the front of the building. I'm excited about it. The town's excited. We're going to have car shows, car cruises. Have a lot of fun, as well as it'll be nice to have everybody in one building and one-stop shopping for your old car or your new car. So I just wanted to share that with the viewers, and if you get a chance, stop in. Like I said, probably about August 20th we'll be open for mechanicals. And one other thing, the last show on High Street for Pottstown Classic is September 7th. And Wheels in Motion sponsors a Hot Wheel race. So if you have any youngsters, grandkids, kids, bring them out. It's really fun at High in Hanover. Kendra, bring the boy. Tell him to test his favorite Hot Wheels. And at High in Hanover, we have a Hot Wheel race for the kids. And it's going to be on PCTV. So the kids will be able to watch themselves on TV. It's always a good event. It's the last show, September 7th. So thank you. And that's it for me, Kendra.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Like I said earlier, you're not busy at all.
No, not crazy at all, no.
All right, well, we've reached about the midpoint now, so let's hear this message from BCTV. We'll be right back.
You're watching Wheels Along the Road on BCTV.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other related stories, go to www.bctv.org. Program underwriting is a valuable source of revenue for bctv.org. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
Welcome back to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. Our special guest this month is Dave MAlloy of Trap Generator Service. And now I'm going to turn the program over to him. Dave, thanks for being here. Please tell us what you've got this evening.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate the opportunity. Hi, I'm Dave MAlloy from Trap Generator Service. We're in Trap, Pennsylvania, and on 7th Avenue. And we have a shop that rebuilds starters, alternators, generators. We also sell new products along with a line of DECA batteries. We make battery cables and do things like that. And Trap Generators have been in business since 1959. And my brother bought the business in 1980. And there's four of us who work there. And Bill Snyder is the shop foreman. Myself and Pat Guineri, we all work there. So it's a small shop. We all get along really good, and we have a pretty decent business, and we'd like to have somebody stop by or give us a call. You can reach us at 489-6378. That's a 610 area code. We're open every day till 5 o'clock and Saturdays from 9 till noon. So I want to talk about some electrical things that you can use, maybe some tips and hints that you can use for your vintage vehicle, or any vehicle really, even a farm tractor or a vintage car, truck, whatever. And first thing I do, I want to talk about safety. Batteries can be dangerous, working around a car can be dangerous, and make sure you wear safety glasses, you don't have any loose clothing or anything like that, and you don't want to get stuck in a fan belt with your necktie or anything like that. That wouldn't be cool at all. And make sure if you're working on an electrical component, such as an alternator or a starter, and you're going to take it off the car, disconnect your battery first. Always disconnect the ground cable first, and when you're all finished, reconnect your ground cable last. That's the safest way to do it, and again, safety first. Nobody likes to get hurt. So we'll start out with batteries. Batteries are basically the electrical heart of any vehicle, approximately the last 100 years since self-starters became prevalent around, or more prevalent around World War I. This is a typical automotive battery. It's a lead acid flooded type battery. That's still the predominant type battery used in the industry today. Although gel and absorbed glass mat batteries are coming to the forefront more as battery technology is rapidly changing. The hybrid vehicles, the electric vehicles, the Chevy Volt, the plug-in vehicles, those kind of things are bringing along the lithium ion type battery and plus driving the AGM and gel battery type batteries. Batteries develop and store electrical energy from a chemical reaction in the lead plates and the electrolyte in the battery. A 12-volt battery, such as this one, has six cells at 2.1 volts per cell, which for a fully charged battery, you get about 12.6 volts for a fully charged battery. And that is a 100% state of charge when you're at 12.6 volts. To get the 12.6 volts, and you say you have a dead battery, your vehicle sits over the winter time, you seldomly use it. You want to charge it up. You don't want to jump start it and go. But when you go to charge a battery with a battery charger, and you're going to spend some money on a battery charger, I recommend that you get an automatic or a smart charger, if you will. And those battery chargers shut themselves off when the battery reaches a full state of charge. The old style battery charger that probably everybody's seen and probably most of us have in our garages, they'll just charge until you either unplug them or the timer goes off or whatever, and they're going to stop whenever they feel like it, not knowing or caring, like a battery charger can care, what state of charge is on the battery. And an important point about the smart chargers is they are essential if you do have a gel or an AGM battery. An AGM or a gel, AGM is absorbed glass mat, cannot tolerate improper or overcharging. The batteries don't last, and those types of batteries are too expensive to keep replacing them every year or so if you're not charging them correctly, if you have a, if it goes dead. I'm sure we've all seen battery tenders, those little green trickle chargers that you see on TV. Dennis Gage on Speed Vision always is plugging them every week. They're a smart charger technology and a trickle charger, and they're a good product. And you, it's a good thing to have it. A smart charger will work for any kind of battery. So if you start your old car up, it hasn't been running for a while, or you can't get a start and you want to charge it, you can check your battery voltage very easily at home. You get a simple multimeter like this one. You can pick these things up at a home warehouse, Home Depot, Lowe's, Walmart probably. They're not a lot of money. You can check them real quick. And Mike, can I use you for a second to hold
sure,
this up?
Sure, what do you need?
Just hold that up for the viewers to see. And it's real easy. You set it on the 20-volt DC scale.
There.
And you hook the red to the positive and the negative to the black to the negative. And that's showing 12.75 volts. So this battery is 100% charged up. It's brand new. I took it off the shelf today to bring it to the show. So that's something you can, without spending a lot of money, you don't have to go anywhere. You can just check it with one of these things. Very simple. So if you don't have a battery charger, which you should get one, they're cheap, don't depend on a jump start and then hope that the generator or alternator is going to charge up your battery. You can get away with it once in a while, but I really don't recommend it because it'll overtax the generator or your alternator. Alternators and generators are built to maintain the battery charge, not to recharge a battery. In the old days, you probably get away with that. There wasn't a lot of electrical loads, but on more modern cars, when you have all the accessories in it, it's running the computer, running the fuel injectors, that kind of thing. You can really overtax those alternators, and that can get expensive. And I sell alternators, but I don't want to sell something that you don't need. When it comes to battery testing, there's lots of schools of thought about testing them. Age is dependent. Batteries have a life. They have a service life. But one of the things you want to do is you want to voltage test it first if it's dead. So if you come across your battery and it's dead, check it the way I just showed you, and then if you have it or you want to take it to a place, a battery shop that has a conductance tester, and a conductance tester tests the conductivity between the plates and the battery. It's a non-destructive test. It's safe. It won't hurt the battery, and it'll give you an idea if you have a shorted out plate or something like that. And if those two tests go are good, you can charge it up, and then you can conduct a load test with the carbon pile. But that is a destructive test, and that does really strain the battery. You want to do that when you want to make sure that the battery is in good health before you do a load test on it. You don't want to blow up a battery. That can get really ugly. So if you do load test it, I recommend you wear your safety glasses, and you maybe want to put a towel over top of the battery while you do it. So we talked about batteries tonight, and the next link in the chain are cables. Cables are extremely important, especially on a vintage car or truck, that they're properly sized, connected, routed, that they're in good condition internally, and you have a nice clean connection on the battery. You can clean it with baking soda solution and rinse it off, and you can get little sprays and whatnot anywhere, and that's a good thing. 6-volt vehicles were pretty much universal up into the 50s, and then as the years went on, everything went to 12 volts, which they still are. But one thing to remember with a 6-volt system is you have half the voltage in your system, you have half the electromotive force to start your vehicle. So therefore, a 6-volt system needs larger cables for less resistance. I brought a couple pieces of cable with me. And this is a 4-gauge cable. And this is typical on what you see on a modern day car. And if you went to a parts house and you need a length of battery cable, sometimes you have them in blister packs with the ends already on them. This is typically what you would see. You see that on the screen there. And that's a 4-gauge. This is a 1-gauge. This is a couple sizes larger. It's larger diameter internally. And you want to have a minimum of a 1-gauge cable on a 6-volt system, as you're going to need it. Again, connections, cleanliness, make sure that the cable's internally, if you can maybe take a razor blade and cut back your insulation a little bit, that it hasn't gone green inside. All those things add up, especially on an old car, that can prevent it from starting properly or hard starts or anything like that, and then you have all kinds of problems. Proper grounding of your electrical system is equally important. The battery needs to ground to the frame, the battery needs to ground to the engine, and the battery needs to ground to the body. Manufacturers use different methods of connecting the battery to these various components. And one of the common way of grounding it, especially on older vehicles, is use a stainless steel, well, it's not stainless steel, but a ground strap that looks like stainless steel. Go from the engine to the ground, or from the battery to the ground, or whatever. That's real important. There's a lot of people come into the shop that have had hard starting issues with vehicles, and it's due to bad connections, either through age. They painted something when they restored it, and they didn't take into account that the ground connection can't get through the paint. So when you're connecting things, you're working on stuff, make sure you have a good clean connection. Scrape the paint off underneath it, put it together with a nice little star washer, and you're good to go. Again, on cables, here's a typical battery connector for a top post battery. This crimps on the battery cable with a special crimping tool. Some people like to solder them. And this is a battery cable repair connection. I'm sure everybody's seen them, and I'm sure everybody's had them on their car or truck at one point. These things will get you home if you need to, but I don't recommend you leave them on your car as a permanent solution for any long period of time. They corrode, they vibrate loose, they cause all kinds of problems, but they will get you home in a pinch. Beats walking. So now we're going to get to talk about starters. Again, following down the chain. This starter is a brand new starter for a late model Ford truck. This is for a V10, like would be an F-250. It's a gas engine starter. And they're pretty small and pretty light these days. Feel that. Look at that.
Wow, yeah.
See that? Mm-hmm. That thing will start a big V10 engine for 100,000 miles or so.
Mm-hmm.
And they have gotten a lot smaller and a lot more efficient as the years go on. Again, I sound like Johnny One Note, but they need to be properly connected, grounded, clean, no paint, connected to your battery cable that either goes to another relay or a starter solenoid, a remote solenoid or a neutral safety switch, and the other wire goes to the ignition switch. They have a tough job to do, start all that mass whenever you want, in all kinds of weather, whenever you wanted to do it, and then shut itself off so it doesn't overspeed and blow the starter up. If you have a sticky ignition switch, you might want to take care of that, because that'll shorten the starter life too. So we got through everything. We're up to starters. And now we need to maintain the charge on the battery that you just diminished by starting your car. And we need to drive our car while we all want to drive it, don't we? Which brings us to generators. Now, I brought a generator with me that Bill rebuilt in our shop the other day. This is happens to be off an old International tractor, but it's very similar to what you might find on a General Motors vehicle from the 40s up to the 60s. This is a 6-volt generator, but a 12-volt looks just like it. The tag is original. A 6-volt one is the tags are black. 12 volts are red. If you're ever looking at one, this also has little oilers on it. You can oil it with a drop of oil. It's kind of cool, really. And they do a real good job. And like Mike was saying, a lot of people upgrade their electrical system when they really don't have to. Like Mike was talking about the brakes. Mm-hmm. Generator in an old, in a vintage car that is stock or darn near stock is perfectly adequate for a vintage vehicle, like in limited use. The generators are basically an electric motor, but the way they're wound, they become a generator, as and they produce power as they're driven by a belt from the engine. Generators have reliably performed their tasks for decades, but there are some disadvantages. The downside to generators is they don't make a lot of power. An old car with vacuum wipers and no power windows or anything like that, all they have to do is run with the points and a little coil in them, and they'll run. They're heavy. I'm not going to hand you the heavy generator.
Okay.
Right? They're big. But the biggest problem is they don't charge at idle. So if you're in stop and go traffic, modern day traffic, you're taxing your battery. Generators don't charge at idle. Make sure the belt's tight, that kind of thing. So batteries or generators were in use up until the mid-60s. Chrysler was the first one to change the alternators in 1960. Although the Lease Neville Corporation sold aftermarket kits that contained alternators back to the 40s. And you saw that they sold them for police cars, ambulances, that kind of thing. They're pretty rare nowadays. But after that, General Motors came on in about 62 or 63, Ford, Studebaker, AMC, all around the same time after that. Some of the advantages of an alternator is they're smaller, they're lighter, they potentially put out much more power, and they charge at idle. So I brought this alternator with me for a couple reasons. One, it's really nice and shiny, and this is a conversion for a street rod or a hot rod, and this is a one-wire alternator that we built in our shop from components. So we didn't buy this from anybody. We built this ourselves from the pieces that we buy from our suppliers. And this alternator happens to be a one-wire alternator. All you need to do is hook up 12 volts to here, mount it on the car, hook up your belt, and no other wires are needed. This is a dummy plug on this one, so you don't need to hook it up. These are really nice if you're doing a conversion, an engine swap, or something like that. The downside to these is if you have the so-called idiot light, charge light on your car, a one-wire alternator will not activate that light. You need to have a voltmeter. So when you're so we sell these chrome things, and we sell a lot of them. A significant part of our business these days is vintage vehicles and modified vehicles, and a lot of guys and women like the chrome alternator. But one thing that you want to be careful of: if you do buy one from someone, if it's not us, it may come with a chrome pulley where the belt rides. We don't recommend the chrome pulley on an old V-belt style alternator. The belt will slip. So we provide a non-chrome pulley to go with the alternator, but we'll give you the chrome and it goes along with it at no charge if you want to change it over. But we really recommend that you keep the chrome pulley off of these alternators. It can save you a lot of aggravation down the road. So we make these right in-house. This is just one that I brought in. This is a Delco style. If it's a General Motors engine, Chevrolet, whatever. And this is, I believe this is 105 amps. So I put, this is about, the generator I showed you a couple minutes ago, that's about 20 amps. So, and that's nice and light too, you know. So I talked about the advantages of the alternators, but there are a couple disadvantages that you should be aware of. They're not really disadvantages, but something you might need to concern yourself with. they cost a little bit more than a generator. But as the years have gone by, the costs have come down, so they're getting pretty equal. Belt tension becomes more important with an alternator. You want to make sure that you can't turn the fan on the alternator or the generator with your finger. You don't want to make the belt tension banjo tight, but tight enough there's a little bit of deflection, but you can't turn, it's a rule of thumb, you can't turn it with your finger. Nowadays, the V-belt system has gone away virtually across the board on all vehicles. They have a serpentine belt with micro grooves in it. That system is extremely durable, they'll last 100,000 miles. I don't recommend the belt lasting that long, but they will. And they really solved a lot of belt problems throughout the years. So we talked pretty much about basic electrical. I just scratched the surface on the topic. If you have any questions, I recommend you give us a call at the shop anytime during the week, 7:30 to 5 p.m., 610-489-6378. We'd be glad to talk to you. We could talk price. If you have any diagnostic questions, feel free to stop down. Feel free to stop in the shop. The shop's been there almost, not quite as old as Mike's shop, built in 1900, but our shop was built in 1927, and it was a farm. So we'd be glad to have you, and again, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here tonight. This was kind of cool.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thanks for bringing the show and tell.
Yeah, sometimes show and tell, exactly.
Yeah. Things, right. You know. Right firsthand. So.
All right, thank you.
Well, it's car quiz time. We're going to see if we can squeeze in one or two before the evening is out. The number here at the studio again is 610-378-0426. And we've already got the first car queued up, correct, Dan?
Yes, there it is. Let's see, what can I tell you about that car? The one behind it is a Buick Skylark.
Does that help?
It's not good. No, not at all. Not at all.
I don't think so.
No. I was also trying to figure out where that picture's taken.
Yeah, where is that?
Yeah, I don't know.
Dreary day? No?
I don't know. There's not a big parking area like that. Again, that's not helping any clue there. But
it's a two-door hardtop.
Yeah.
How's that?
Yeah. Yep. This was considered maybe a muscle car, too. If anybody out there thinks about muscle cars, you think about a 64 GTO. Well, the idea of a muscle car is you get the automobile makes larger engine and put it in their shorter chassis, and that's what you have here. You have the short chassis made by that company, and you have their big engine made by that company, and you put them two together, and you end up with a muscle car. So, what else can I say about that?
No home viewers yet. We stumped them, Kendra.
Stumped them.
Man, yeah, hard to do, too.
I was talking about aftermarket stuff earlier. These cars did not come with turn signals. If you wanted them, it cost you $15 extra. It would be an option. How about backup lights? Another $15 option. Couple things we take for granted. I guess
yeah,
you need
there,
that.
There's the generator overcharging, all the accessories, right?
All right, you know where to call.
These guys did not have air conditioners, but they had conditioned air heaters and defrosters. That's the way they described it. They had two different kinds, a standard, which costs you $45, cheap, and the deluxe at $60. And it surprises me that they are so inexpensive for that, but you know, maybe they didn't work as good as today's. So,
oh, we got a fish.
Oh, we got, okay, home viewer, yes, what is that?
I believe it's a 1950 Oltopio 88.
You got it.
Got it.
Futuramic Holiday Coupe.
Pardon?
Futuramic Holiday Coupe.
Yep, hydromatic transmission.
Wow. Yep.
Maybe the fastest car in the road in them days.
Oh, wow.
They were a hot set of wheels there.
Yeah, see, that now, do you remember them, or did you have one at one time?
I never owned one. My neighbor had one. He bought a new one.
Oh, okay.
A new thing could really move.
Did he give you rides in it?
I rode in it a number of times. I drove it a few times.
Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't have to tread that down very far before you were really going.
Yeah.
Great car it was.
Yeah. Do you remember what size engine they had?
I don't remember the size. Okay. I know it's called the 88. Yep. V8. It was a V8 engine.
It's a 303 cubic inch engine.
I couldn't tell you. They also built a 98, which is a bigger engine, a bigger automobile.
But that was a larger chassis, too.
Pardon?
That was a larger chassis. So this is the short chassis with
big
the
engine.
Same big engine.
Yeah. So. This was a very neat car.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thanks for calling in.
Appreciate a great show there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Yep. All right. I think...
one more?
I think, well... Okay. Well, there's another one.
Got to call in quick. We're running out of time.
Yeah.
The clock is ticking.
TV it's people just hollered at us. We don't have much time. You didn't really holler. So.
Someone has to keep us in line.
Yeah, somebody has to keep us in line. This was designed by Virgil Exner. It's a new design for this year. It was called the $100 Million Look. And... no six cylinders for that brand of car.
No one called. I guess we're going to have to.
I can tell them what it means or what it is. That is a 1955 Chrysler Windsor Deluxe. Okay. You could get Highlander interior again, the plaid interior. You could get
it
for those. Yeah.
Nice.
I got
that
right here in my notes. Okay.
All right. Well, we just said, our time is wrapping up. I hope that we see you all at the 48th Annual Duryea Day, August 1st. Thank you, Dan, Mike, and Dave for being here this evening.
Thank you, Kendra. Yep.
And for the museum, I'm Kendra Cook, and I'll see you in September. The first thing.